using Galera or PXC or here? No, I think you are all advanced after the office talk. I think is it too loud? No, or is it okay? Okay. For me, it's loud. No issue. Okay, so now that you are experienced, we will go. I will try to give you some tips. I will try to give you 15, but depending on the time, maybe you will a bit less, and then the slides will be online somewhere. So let me change the resolution. 1 second. Is it better? Yeah, you see it completely now. Okay, so who am I? I'm Lefret. I work for Podcona. And I installed my first Galera cluster just at Fosden in February 2010, just after a talk of Seppo, so the guys who created the Coloship. So it's a long time already now. And it was just after my talk there. So I will try to give you these 15 tips. Ready? So the first thing I want to try to explain you is how to do, how to perform this pointing time recovery. So with MySQL, everybody knows how to do that, or I hope so. With Galera, it's maybe more difficult. So binary lock must be enabled. It seems strange because we use binary events, but in Galera, it's not needed to enable the binary locks. You can run it without enabling. The format should be raw, but you can just ignore them. So you need to enable that if you want pointing time recovery, and you need also to have log slave updates enabled. Then, this is a cluster. Less fancy than the one with Arc, okay? And everybody's writing on that cluster. Then, suddenly what happens? Demo, truncate a prediction table. Thank you, Dimitri, to have done this. Yeah, he was not in his normal state, so. So we can have two scenarios for our system. The first one is the application can keep running without that table. It's just a table that we won't use currently or that we would like to recover data, but it's not mandatory to have it. You can disable a function in the application just for that table, but the rest should be still available. Or the application must be stopped directly when this happens, and we need to proceed to the restore of that. So I will start with the application that has to be completely stopped, right? So we have extra backup running every day, and it creates all these backups very nicely. We're happy with that. We have the binary logs, and so the steps are easy. We need first to stop each node of the cluster because the application won't access it anymore. So this is easy on Linux, right? Nothing special there. Then we need to find the position before the event, let's say the event happened, before demo touched our database. So how we do that? We just go in the binary log. We search for this event and we find. And there we got the position, right? So what we do, we're going to restore the backup on one node, and then, so we just apply the logs and we do all the backup stuff to restore our backup. Then we're going to start the node. Watch out that your application should not connect to it, right? And after that, we're going to replay all the binary log from the backup since the position of the event. So this is quite easy. It's almost like a normal MySQL server, right? Then when we have done this, we start the other nodes one by one and then perform the SST. SST, I'll explain you what it is. So it's a full snapshot of that machine. So that machine now has the node, has the right data, and we want it back to all the other nodes. Then we enable it from the application. So nothing really tricky in this case. Just that you need to stop everything, then one by one add them, or at least first one and wait before joining the other ones. So when we need to keep the application running, so we have still extra backup, we still have the binary logs, then the steps are a bit different. We need to take care of the quorum. I will show you some quorum stuff later. So the thing is that we have three nodes in our design, in our environment, and if we remove one, if something happens to one of the nodes, everything will be, all the cluster will be stopped. So we need to take care of that. So how can we take care of this quorum? It's by adding an arbitrator. So it will be a fake node that will be just there for the quorum. Or we can change the weight of one node. But I will explain you that later. Or just ignore it and watch out. So then we need to find again the position, right? And we will remove one node from the cluster. We will restore the table there, and after that we will just dump it and repopulate the cluster with it. So we stop it, start MySQL, but now we don't want to join the cluster at all on that node where we're gonna do the restore, right? So binary log until the event, we have seen how to do that. Then we need to export a table like MySQL dump, for example. And then we import this table on the two other nodes, the nodes that are still running, right? And when that is done, we're going to restart MySQL again on the offline node and let me perform SST from one of the two nodes running. So this is the only difference. So that was quite to warm up us with the tips. So it's just point-in-time recovery. So next tip is we try to reduce the latency time during extra backup SST. I have a room with a customer. It has three terabytes of data in this cluster, and SST takes 9 hours. So it's not, the line is not that good, so he's not very happy with that. And implementing some of the stuff I will tell you now, we reduce this SST time to a bit less than 2 hours. So you can gain. It depends on the design of your table, of course. So when we perform SST, the donor with extra backup, you can keep the donor alive. So compared to what Art said, that we are always, the node is offline at that time, it's not really, it depends. So with extra backup, we can keep it. But watch out, because during the backup, we'll increase some load on that node. And sometimes you don't want that this, the donor, so it's where the backup is it's made, the donor, you don't want to keep it for too long. So here we're going to reduce the time on the donor. It means if we use the time somewhere, we're going to increase the time of the restore, of the preparation of the new node. But that's less important for production. So how we do that? We're going to use the new extra backup 2.1 feature that will help us to reduce this time. So an example how to do that. We need to use extra backup v2. That was a mistake Art was talking. It's that when we change, we didn't make this V2 in the first release, and then it was not compatible with the other ones. So after we use SST, we use XB stream as a stream format, and then in extra backup we use compress, compact. We do it in parallel if we have multiple tables. And we compress everything in parallel. Doing that, it will be faster. The load will be a bit higher on the donor, but the donor will stay in donor state for less time. So that's the goal, in fact. Okay. So that was my second tip. Again, 13. So now we have seen. Art explained that we can also have asynchronous state, so normal replication between Galera clusters and normal MySQL. So this is what we have here. Okay, we have our cluster, we have one machine here taken for, I don't know, make some bad reports or to have a backup somewhere else differently or to do logical backups. Anyway, we have this asynchronous machine there that points to his master. But what happened when the master disappeared? What we do? We say, okay, let's say no, the master is B. Will that work? Of course not, it won't work. Because position 5, it's different. So you will need to know what position you need to point it. So we are in 5-5, okay? So that's an issue. So how can we know that? The trick here, the tip will be about finding this position. So how to do that? We will need to find the last received XID in the relay log. So on the slave, we check in the relay log using a master bin log, and we try to find this XID. So how we do that? It's like this, master bin log, the relay, we check the last lines of it, and we find the last XID, right? Then that we know this number, we will the master we want to promote as master, right? So in this case it was server B. We will try to find where the XID was in this binary logs. So we check the last one, or when we know what happened to the crap, we check the binary log, which we search for this XID number we have, and we find the position. Right? So we know which binary log it is, we know the position, so we just use that in the change master statement. Okay? So this was how to change an asynchronous slave 5.5 to a cluster, a Galera cluster 5.5. Next, this is how to do it. You need to start. So next slide, next thing. Now, how can we do that with 5.6? With 5.6, if you have DKID enabled, it's easier. But it requires rsync SSD. Does somebody know why? And not extra backup. Nobody? Because, yeah, you know, I hope. So we need the binary logs for DKID correctly and find the right position. If you don't have the binary logs, it won't work. When you do rsync SSD, you copy also the binary logs, if they are in the database. If not, with extra backup, not since yesterday, yeah, 2 days ago. So, since 2 days ago, so on Tuesday, extra backup 2.17 came out, and 2 days after, we have a new version that supports the binary log also. We copy the last binary log in extra backup. So it will help people to just point to the new, to another node, and it will just work. Just change the master to another node, and it's done. So much easier in 5.6, okay? Next tip. So, sometimes, and I think you already, most of you may have experienced that, is that you take a node out for any reason, then you put it back and you expect that it will do this IST much faster than the SST. And it does what? SST. And you say, oh, why again an SST? And I was down for several minutes. I work for a customer, it could be down for 1 minute. So you could stop a machine for 1 minute. After 1 minute, he has to do again SST every time. So why this? Just because when a node goes offline and when it comes back in the cluster, it will send the last event he replicated for. And so if this event is found in the cache on the node he choose as a donor, then it will do as IST. If it's not there, then SST will be mandatory. So the trick point here is this cache, so where all the write sets are, and this is the Galera cache. So by default is 128 megabytes, which So for some people, so it's enough. But for a very heavy system, this is not enough. I told you, for one of the customers, it was just 1 minute. So it was not enough. So you need to increase the size of the gallery cache. So this is in the Gcache size in the provider option. Yeah. And it's up to you to know what the size you are, what do you expect to put there. But if you increase that, the machine can stay longer without not in the cluster. And when you join it, it will perform IST if it finds the donor in this cache. Bigger is the cache, more chance you have to find it back, right? So now that we know this, next tip is then, how can we choose the right donor? And here it's a bit tricky. If you lose track, just stop me and say, oh, I'm losing track. So this is our cluster, right? And in the cache, we all have the first event. Then our dear, one of the nodes goes out, right, of the cluster. And we are still writing, so we have a second event, okay? Then we come back and you say, okay, my last event was one. And you select B. Then B said, okay, I have one, so the next one we need two, and it does the IST, very quick, very nice, in parallel, everything, we like it. So now everybody has event two, and everybody is again on the cluster. Now, put it out this machine, format everything, because it was there was an issue, then go back to the cluster, and you said, okay, I don't have anything here, SST, full copy of the data there, it takes more time. So after that, we have this. Not really like that, yeah. So we have this, so he has, he's back here, then a new write, event three, and his cache was empty, then he has event three now, in his cache. We are happy. Then, let's remove B for something. Then our cluster is only this one, and we're still writing. So here, event four in the cache. Then we remove again C, and because it was a really bad machine, we replace the disk. We put it back. We still write event six. Then this one comes back in the cluster, and he says, hello, my last event was three. And he selects C, and C will say, oh, I don't have three, so SST again, full copy. But if he would have choose this one, he would have said, okay, I have three, and I will give you that. So it will be much faster. So here, it would be nicer to say, okay, that would be very cool, in fact. But the donor election is not clever enough yet to find that, to know that. So you need to tell it, okay, go for A because A has the data, and you will be able to do IST. But for that, you need to know, does A has the data you want? So, with Stacksys, on 5.6 and with Galera 3, you have now the possibility to know what's the lowest sequence in the cache for a node. So this is reciprocal cache down 2. So when you know that, you will be able to, yeah. When that, there is two ways to know which one it is. It's, you go on grassdate.dat, and you will find, okay, it's the sequence here, it's 11, right? And here, so you go on a node, and you say, okay, which one, you run it like this, and it will just print it here, 11. So, this is all you can recover on the node that you want to join. What was the last event you have? Then you check on your node, and you check on your node this for this status, and you will know who has the 11, for example. Okay, so this is how to do IST when a machine has different cache events inside. So now, if you want to to know, okay, this is my my cluster and it runs right, and I want to know how much more I can add on that cluster. So since 5.5.3 we have this this sync, right? And we can use that to find how fast a node can replicate. So the process, it's a bit, again, a bit complicated, but we'll put the slides online also if you want to do it again. We will try to collect the amount of transaction, so all these events, during peak time for a time range. Here, I just take 1 minute. And this is all you do. So you do show global status, and you have last committed. You sleep, last committed, and then you have, in 1 minute, what happened there. Okay, so this is the number of events, and we did 138 transactions per second. Okay, this is what's happening right now in the peak time on this machine. So now we want to collect the amount and the duration of the process when we are in desync mode, and then to see how much more we could do, for example. So how we do that? So we will put the node in desync mode. So what will be desync mode? It's just that the node will be seen by the cluster as a like a donor, that it won't send flow control. So it means that if it's not able to replicate fast enough, it won't say to the other nodes, hey guys, I'm not able to replicate, wait, don't allow other transaction right now. So this is just what the flow control is. So you remember it's at about 0.1 and then 1. When you are 1, you are paused and nobody, the cluster just wait that the slowest one recover. So how we do that now? So we will put the machine in desync. We will flush the table to the read lock, so not allow any change there. And we're gonna wait for 1 minute, and then we're gonna again unlock all the tables. Okay. So in another terminal, here I use my gadget because it's easier. It's written by my colleague Jay, and it's a command line tool to see what's happening in all my SQL stuff. And it has also option for Chimera. So we're gonna see, and we check the queue to see when we go when it goes down. So here, this is when we unlock, because we start to process stuff. Then here, this is when we catch up, because we go down and we see now the difference of the time. So it means that in 82 seconds we were able to perform that amount of transaction. So at the full speed of Galera, the configuration you are running right now, at the full speed, you can do 242 transactions per second. So you mean that the capacity right now is 57% of what we could do before we will send flow controls often. So this is a nice tip to find that on Galera. Okay, so multicast replication. So by default, Galera use unicast TCP, and it does one copy of the message to all the nodes of the cluster. So, but it's possible because if you use more nodes, you need to have more bandwidth every time. So if your network allows it, you can also, it supports it, you can use UDP replication. So it is easy, you just need to do provider option, GMcast, MCast address, and the multicast. And you can join using the multicast address your cluster. So that was also something nice to know. Now, SSL. So if you want to do SSL, because Galera allows you to do SSL, you can do all the replication via SSL, but it's also possible to use for SST, SSL with extra backup and with rsync. So for rsync, you need to use another SST script, but it's possible. So I will go very fast on how to do that, but we need to create a certificate, we need to copy them, and this is the configuration we need to use. Let me show you how you just put in the SST in your mind CNF how it works. For rsync, same, you need to use another you need to use SOCAT and use another SST script. So and need to go speed up to give you other tricks. So when you have a GR, if you have a cluster running, maybe sometimes you see that you have a GRA log files on your data here, right? So but what are these GRA files? So there, for each GRA you will see something in the error log. And it means that something failed, it's a replication failure. But if you want to really decode what's happening there, it's possible. So you need to download the binary header for binlog. You can find it at that URL. Then you need to join with the log file you have, like this. And then just use MySQL binlog and see what was the issue. So it's quite very easy to see what happened. You can also log more in Galera using these options to debug. Okay, I have 1 minute more. So when you want to avoid SST when you join a node, so you need to have extra backup, you need to have Galera info, and you need to have Gcache big enough for the reason that I explained before, right? So you restore backup on a node, you display the content of the Galera info, so you looks like that, and you can create a file like this and put back that, and most of the time it works. It's a bit tricky, but it works. So instead of doing SST, you will do IST there, which is nice. Yeah, the version comes from this, right? So if we, who's the next one, Adrian, are you ready? Okay, so I will just show you some quorum, or you can cheat with that. And so this is what happens. When network issue happens, oh, no writes here, what happens? The cluster is still running. When this happens, what will be the issue? In fact, none will accept anything anymore because they don't have 50% of quorum. So this is a split brain. So to fix that, you need to use an arbitrator, for example, or you can cheat with giving some weight to your nodes. And this is all you need to have. For the rest, go to the website, on the website when I publish them. Sorry, we are short in time.
Is we gaan per Kona University doen en in eind februari
20
hier in Brussel. Dus we hebben een kilometer vandaan. 20 februari.
Dat is goed, zo. We komen nog wel terug. We hebben een eerste keer.
Smakelijk.
Precies.
Dat is een beetje leuk. Thank you. Het is de eerste keer in al die jaren dat ik geen parking gevonden heb.